Hello friends, welcome to Learner's Planet. Friends, in the previous session, we discussed some problems from CAT 2001. In this session, we'll be taking some more problems from the paper, same paper, and I would advise you to attend the basic sessions before coming to this session. Okay, and I hope you must be having your paper and pen with you. So you just solve the problem or maybe try to solve the problem on your own, then match your answer and solution with mine. Okay, just pause the session, read the problem, solve on your own, then match. Okay, so let's begin the session. Now friends, let's take this problem. It's a big story. There's a lot of work in preparing a birthday dinner. Even after the turkey is in oven, there's still the potatoes and gravy, yam, salads and cranberries, not to mention setting the table. Three friends, Asit, Anand and Afzal, work together to get all this chorus done. The time it takes them to do the work together is 6 hours less than Asit would have taken working alone, 1 hour less than the Arnold would have taken alone, and half the time Afzal would have taken working alone. How long would it take them to do this chorus working together? Now friends, it's a really big story, but the problem part is from here only. This portion, this half portion. Okay, so this is the total part of the problem. Otherwise, the remaining story is as for calculation of the answer, it's not at all required. Okay, now suppose we assume that the total time which they are taking is X hours, right? Now the first one is taking 6 hours less. The time it takes them to do the work together is 6 hours less than Asit would have taken. That means Asit would be taking X plus 6 hours if he is working alone, and Arnold is taking 1 hour less than. So it will be X plus 1. Arnold will be taking X plus 1 if he is working alone. And this third guy, that is half the time he will be taking, that is X, he will be taking 2X hours. Okay, so X hours is when all of them are working together. This is if the first guy is working all alone, if the second guy is working all alone, if the third guy is working all alone. That means these are their individual capacities. Now, according to time and work, we have to calculate the unit work. Okay, so in 1 hour, this guy will be doing 1 upon X plus 6 work. This guy will be doing 1 upon X plus 1 work, and this guy will be doing 1 upon 2X work. So in all, if they are working together, they will be doing 1 upon X work. That is, in 1 hour, these three guys will be doing 1 upon X works. X work, he is doing 1 upon X plus 6 work. In 1 hour, he is doing 1 upon X plus 1 work. In 1 hour, and he is doing 1 upon 2X work. So I hope till here you are clear. Now we have to calculate the value of X. Now there are two options. Either you go by option or you just solve the equation. First of all, let's simplify it. Okay, this will be going here, and it will 1 upon X minus 1 upon 2X is 1 upon 2X. Now you will be getting a quadratic equation if you solve it, or you can go by option. Whatever the method suits you, that you can adopt. What my idea is to just go by option. Instead of solving a quadratic equation, take the help of option and eliminate the absurd options. Okay. Now, how to eliminate the absurd option? Just listen to me very carefully. Now, suppose the answer is 20 minutes. Since we are doing the entire calculation in hours, so we have to take this 20 minutes in hours. Okay. So that would be 1 by 3 hour. Now, suppose X is 1 by 3. So if you put X 1 by 3 over here, so what you'll be getting in the denominator, that is 1 by 3 plus X, that is 19 by 3, isn't it? That means in denominator, you'll be getting 19. Okay. And you'll be getting some data over here also. But in the right hand side, if you see, if you put X is 1 by 3, you won't be getting any factor or multiple of 19. So it will be not worth to solve for X is equal to 20 minutes. Okay. So I just eliminate this option. Similarly, if I take 30 minutes, that is half an hour. So it's 1 plus 1 by 2 plus 6, that is 13 by 2. Okay, so further, I'll be getting 30 over here and some number over here. And in the right hand side, if the 2x will be what? It's 1. Okay, if x is half an hour. So further, this data and this data, they are going apart. Okay, so even 30 minutes cannot be the correct option. Now, if I take 40 minutes, it will be 2 by 3 hours. Okay, suppose I put 2 by 3 over here. So, what I'll be getting? 6, 3 are 18 plus 2, 20. So, now denominator is coming a decent value. Okay, so what that will be, just put 2 by 3 and see whether the left-hand side and right-hand side are matching or not. Now, 2 by 3 plus 6, that is 3, 6 are 18 plus 2, 20. So, it will be 3 by 20 plus, it's 2 by 3 plus 1, that is 3 plus 2, 5, so it's 3 by 5, or you can say it's 12 by 20, so it's 15 by 20, or we can say 3 by 4. So the left hand side is 3 by 4 if you put x as 2 by 3, or if you put x as 2 by 3 over here, so it's 2 into 2, 4, and it is 3. So right hand side also you are getting 3 by 4. So if you put x as 40 minutes, you'll be getting left hand side and right hand side as same. That means 40 minutes is the correct answer. And how did we eliminate the remaining option? That is, we discarded the like options which are not suiting over here, or the options which are giving the absurd denominators. Okay. So this technique will be really useful for your examination time when you have to save the time, because time is really a constant in CAT examination. And I hope you are clear with this technique. Now friends, let's take this problem. Fresh grapes contain 90% water by weight, while dried grapes contain 20% water by weight. What is the weight of dry grapes available from 20 kilogram of fresh grapes? Now, there is no paperwork required at all. Since we are having 20 kilogram of fresh grapes, so I just calculate the amount of pulp. So in fresh grapes, 90% is water, that means 10% is pulp, right? So 10% pulp, that means 2 kilogram is pulp. Now we have to get the dry grapes from this. So in dry grapes, water is only 20%. So we are having the pulp as 2 kilogram. Now this makes the 80% of the dry grapes. Okay, since dried grapes contains 20% water, that means 80% is pulp. Now 80% is this figure, that means 20% figure will be half a kilogram. Okay, so in all the weight should be 2.5 kilogram. So no paperwork is required at all. I hope you are getting me. The problem looks like difficult, seems to be difficult, but actually if you analyze it, it will be really easy to do. Okay. Now let's take this problem. Train X departs from station A at 11 a.m. for station B, which is 180 kilometers so far. Train Y departs from station B at 11 a.m. for station A. Train X travels at an average speed of 70 km per hour and doesn't stop anywhere until it arrives at station B. Train Y travels at an average speed of 50 km per hour, but it has to stop for 15 minutes at station C, which is 60 km away from station B to station A. Now we have to find out the distance to the nearest kilometer from station A to the point where the train cross each other. Okay. Now this is a problem based on relative speed concept. This is station A, this is station B. The train X is starting from here at the speed of 70, and this is the other train which is starting from this place at the speed of 50 km per hour. I assume that this is the point C, that is 60 kilometers from this place, right? Now speed of this train is 50 km per hour. So to cover 60 kilometers, it will be taking 6 by 5 hours. Okay. So what 6 by 5 hours? It is 72 minutes. Okay. So this train is taking 72 minutes to reach this place. That means to run 60 kilometers. After that, it is taking a stoppage, or we can say it is taking a halt for 15 minutes. So it's, that means practically this train is taking 87 minutes to start from the station C. Okay. So in 87 minutes, we are just getting the around idea. In 87 minutes, this train will reach at which place. Okay. So in, it is taking, to run 70 kilometers, it is taking around 1 hour. Okay, it's taking 1 hour. Now it has some 27 minutes extra, so that is around half an hour. So around half an hour, that is 35 kilometer. We can just assume it to be maybe 32 kilometer. Okay, so 70 plus 32, around 102 kilometer. So in 87 minutes, this train will be running for 102 kilometer. So from this place, this is 102 kilometer, and this place is 60 kilometer. Now this train is here, that is train X is here, train Y is here. Now this is the distance is 102 kilometer, this distance is 160, that means this distance is around 18 kilometer. Okay, now this train is also starting, this train is also starting. A fresh start we can assume. Now both of them have to run for 18 kilometer, and their relative speed is, since they are coming from each other's side, so the relative speed is 120 kilometer per hour. Okay, so distance by speed will be time, and I just convert that time into minutes. So they will take 9 minutes to cross each other. Okay, but we have to find out the distance from this place, that is from station A. So in 9 minutes we can find out the distance covered up by this train, that is the train X. Okay, since it is running 70 kilometer per hour. Okay, that means in 60 minutes it is running 70 kilometers. Okay, 60 minutes 70 kilometer. So in 9 minutes it will be taking, it will be running for these many kilometers. Okay, that's around 11-12 kilometers. Okay, or we can say something, I'm sorry, it's around 10.5 kilometers from this place. Okay, from this place, I'm sorry. So 102 plus 10.5, that is around 112 kilometers, which is this option. Okay, so the problem seems to be difficult, but actually it is not. Bit calculation and bit analysis is required. I hope you are clear. Now we have a good problem. In fact, I can say great problem. A set of consecutive positive integers beginning with 1 is written on the blackboard. A student came along and erased one number. The average of the remaining numbers is 35, 7 by 17. What was the number erased? Now this data is really tedious data, you can say, right? Now the average is around 35. Okay, so we can get an around idea of the total numbers. If the average is 35, that means the total numbers should be something around 68 to 70, in between 68 to 70, because average of 70 numbers is 35.5. okay, so it's bit less than that. So we can assume that the total numbers initially they are maybe 60, between 68 to 70, right? Now since we are the person is erasing one number, and the average of the remaining number is 35, 7 by 17. Now while calculating the average, we divide the sum of the numbers by number of the numbers. Okay, that is, in this case we are getting 17 in the denominator. That means the total number of numbers should be a multiple of 17, then only we can get this sort of data. So between if we choose a correct number from this range, we can see that 17 is factor of 68. Okay, so we just can assume that there are initially 69 numbers initially, and after erasing one number we are getting 68 numbers. Okay, so the average of 68 numbers, if we find, so we can get the 17 in the denominator. Okay, else there are no chances to get 17 in the denominator. Now we have got the around idea of initial numbers and the new set of numbers. Now we have to find out which number is erased. First of all, let's find out the sum of the numbers from 1 to 69. That will be 69 into 70 by 2. Right? So it's around 2415. Okay, just multiply these two, we'll be getting 2415. Now we have to find out the total of this new set. Now average is 35, 7 by 17, so it is 602 by 17. Now this is average, and this is the total number of numbers. So the total is 2408. Now this is the initial total. This is the total after erasing one number. So the difference will give us the number which is erased. So that is number 7. Okay. Friends, here I have used the formula n plus 1 by 2 to find the sum of first n natural numbers, or I can say first n positive integers. Okay. And we have to just think that this 17 cannot be achieved in average unless until there is a multiple of 17 in the numbers. Okay. So that's how I got the idea of 68. So if 68 is the number after erasing, number of numbers after erasing one particular number, that means initially the numbers will be 16. Okay. Yeah, or the numbers had been 69. Okay. So I hope you are clear. Now let's see this question. Ujjakar and Keshav attempted to solve a quadratic equation. Ujjakar made a mistake in writing down the constant term. He ended up with the roots 4 and 3. And Keshav made a mistake in writing down the coefficient of x. He got the roots as 3 and 2. What will be the exact roots of the original quadratic equation? Friends, it's a quite a simple problem. You must be knowing that how a quadratic equation forms, right? Now suppose I have two roots a and b. So what will be the quadratic equation if the roots are a and b? That will be x minus a into x minus b is equal to 0, right? So if you just expand it, what you'll be getting? X square minus a plus bx plus ab is equal to 0. So this is what the quadratic equation is, right? Now roots are a and b. What is the coefficient of x? That is sum of the roots in negative. Sum of the roots in negative. And what is the constant term? That is product of the roots, right? Now the first one, Ujjakar is making a mistake in writing down the constant term, right? That means he is making the mistake in writing down this constant term. That means we can say he might have written the sum of the roots correctly, right? So he ended up with the roots 4 and 3. Since he has made the mistake in writing down the constant term incorrect, so we assume that he has written the sum of the roots s correctly, that is coefficient of x. So what is sum of the roots? That is 4 plus 3, 7, right? So our answer should be having the sum of the roots as 7, right? So this is here also and here also, right? Now the other one, he's got the roots as 3 and 2, and he has written down the coefficient of x incorrectly. That means we can assume that he has written down the product of the roots correctly, that is constant term, right? So he's making the mistake in writing down the coefficient of x. He got the roots 3 and 2. So we assume that he might have written the product of the roots correctly. So what is the product of the roots? Since he is getting the roots as 3 and 2, so product of the roots will be 3 into 2, that is 6. So our answer should contain the product of the roots as 6. So that is in this option only, right? So 6 and 1 is the correct choice. Further, I just make a quick recap. The first one is making the mistake in writing down the constant term. That means he has written down the coefficient of x correctly. That means sum of the roots, that is 7, that is correct, right? That is 4 plus 3. The other one is making the mistake in writing down the coefficient of x. That means product of the root is correct. That is 3 into 2, that is 6. So we want sum to be 7 and product to be 6. That is fulfilled only in the option A, right? So this is the correct choice. I hope you are clear. Now friends, further we have a question based on permutation combination or arrangement of numbers. Let n be the number of different 5 digit numbers divisible by 4 with the digits 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. No digit being repeated in the numbers. What is the value of n? That means we have to find out how many numbers will be divisible by 4 if we make the numbers from these digits, right? We are having 6 digits with us. So in all there will be 6 factorial numbers can be formed, with each and every digit should be used once in that particular number, right? That means no repetition of numbers, digits in is allowed in the numbers. Now, in all 720 numbers are there, but we have to find out the number of numbers which are divisible by 4, right? Now, what is the divisibility test of 4? That the last two digits should be divisible by 4. Right? So we have 6 digits with us, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. Now we have to make 5 digit numbers. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We have 5 places with us. Right? Now, since the number has to be divisible by 4, the last 2 digits should be divisible by 4. Now we have to make the combination of last 2 digits so that entire number can be divisible by 4. But each and every digit should be used once only, right? Now we start with 1, right? And we are just making a combination of last two digits, right? So with 1 at this place, 1, 2, 12 is divisible by 4, then 1 and 6, 16 is divisible by 4. So we have two choices for this number. Then here if it is 12 and here if it is 16. So for this place we have how many choices? In all we have 6 numbers. So out of these 6, 2 are going over here. So we are left with 4 choices. So for the first place we have 4 choices, for the second place we have 3 choices, and for the third place we have 2 choices. For this and this we have 1, 2, then 1, 6. So what we do, we just find out the combinations over here, that is 4 into 3 into 2. So 24 combinations for this, 24 combinations for this, right? Now next combinations also we try to find out. Now if at this place 2 is there, so 2, 4 is also multiple of 4. For that 24 combination, then we start with 3. So 3, 2 and 3, 6. For the 24 combination, for 36, 24 combinations, then we take 4. So for 4, 4, 2 will not be divisible by 4, 4, 6 will not be divisible by 4. So we have to skip 4, then we come to 5. So 5, 2, for the 24 choices, 52 is multiple of 4, then 56 is multiple of 4. So for the 24 choices, now from 6, 64 is multiple of 4. So further we have 24 choices. Now 24 choices, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 24 choices for 8 times, that gives us 192, right? So this is how this problem can be done. You must be knowing the divisibility test of 4, and the last 2 digits must be divisible by 4. So just have to make the combination of the other numbers, keeping the last two digits as 12, 16, 24, 32, 36, 52, 56 and 64. I hope you are clear. Now, let's see this question. A change making machine contains 1 rupee, 2 rupee and 5 rupee coins. The total number of coins is 300. The amount is rupees 960. If the number of 1 rupee coin and 2 rupee coin are interchanged, the value comes down by rupees 40. What is the total number of 5 rupee coin? Quite a simple problem. It's 1 rupee, 2 rupee and 5 rupee. I assume the number of coins of 1 rupee is X, this is Y and this is Z. Now total number of coins are 300 and their value is 960. Now how can we come to the value? Suppose this is x rupees, the x coins, the value of 1 rupees will be x rupees. If 2 y rupee coin are there, then the complete value will be 2y, that is double of this. And similarly, if z coins are there of 5 rupees, then the total value will be 5z. So x plus 2y plus 5z is 960. Now what is told, if the number of coins of 1 rupee and 2 rupee are interchanged, the value comes down by 40. Now what will be the value if x coins are there of 2 rupees and y coins are there of 1 rupee? So it's 2x and it is y, right? So if y plus 2x plus 5z, the value is coming down by 40 rupees, so the new value is 920 rupees. Okay, so suppose I deduct this from this, what I'll be getting? It's y minus x is equal to 40 rupees. Okay. Now, what I do, I just add both of them. So what I'll be getting? 3x plus 3y plus 10z is equal to 960 plus 920, that is 1880, right? Now 3. X plus y, I just take the value of x plus y from here, that is 300 minus z. Plus 10z is 1880. Now it is 900 minus 3z plus 10z is 1880. That means 7z is equal to 1880 minus 900, that is 980, that means z is 140. So 140 coins were there of rupees 5. Okay, z was the number of coins of 5 rupees. Okay, I hope you are clear. Friends, we have done good number of questions in this session. In the next session, we'll be taking more problems of previous year CAT papers. So do revise this session and the previous session, and see you in the next session. Bye bye.